This morning on Partners in Good Health, the topic is stroke, what to do when it strikes. Our guest is Dr. Italo Linfante. He is Director of Interventional Neuroradiology at Baptist Health South Florida. Dr. Linfante, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, June. It's a pleasure being here.
First of all, what is a stroke and what are the warning signs?
So a stroke is, first of all, we need to divide up the stroke. Basically, there's two types of strokes. One type is when an artery inside of the brain, a vessel inside of the brain bursts and you have a brain bleed. So brain bleeds, first type. Second time, when there's a clot that blocks off the circulation of blood to the brain. In this case, you have something we call ischemia. So the ischemic stroke, meaning the lack of blood flow to the brain, is basically like a heart attack. So a brain attack is like a heart attack. And in this case, warning signs are sudden onset of weakness on one side, difficulty speaking. These are the most worrisome warning signs. For a bleed, the most important warning sign is a sudden onset of the worst headache of someone's life. So a severe headache at onset. In this case, you have to go to the emergency room immediately.
All right. Well, that sort of answers my next question, because when you start to feel these symptoms coming on, or you're with someone who is exhibiting these symptoms, what do you do first? What is the very first thing?
So that's absolutely right. Unfortunately, most of these patients, because the brain is involved, most of these patients either they're not aware of what's happening, either they lose consciousness, or they can't speak. So the people who are close to them are basically the people who are going to be the most important providers, because they're the one who have to call 911 and bring the patient closest to the closest emergency room.
So call 911.
911 is the most important thing to do for someone who's close to someone who has a stroke. If the stroke is not that severe at the beginning and the patient can call itself 911, but that's more rare. The most common thing is someone who's close to them can call 911. The most the saddest part sometimes in stroke is that the patient falls to the ground and is found on the ground by a family member or a loved one.
Okay. So if that happens, that's a very scary thing to think about. Yes. You're with someone and they fall to the ground, and I think probably what you really want to do is reach down and help that person, but it's important to remember to call 911 first and get help on the way.
Yes.
What's the potential impact of a stroke on an individual or his or her family?
That's another great question. So as according to recent data, stroke is the third leading cause of death in this country. Same thing, we have similar data now that medicine is becoming more global. We have similar data from Asia and South America, and it's the same thing. So number one is heart attack, number two is cancer, number three is stroke. So it has a tremendous impact on our society. And also stroke is the first cause of disability.
What's an aneurysm, and are aneurysms life-threatening?
Yes. So aneurysm is basically a weak spot in the artery. It's like a bubble on a tire, to put it this way. So because, of course, the brain receives one-fifth of the cardiac output, so receives a tremendous amount of blood all the time, because we do a lot with our brains. And so this bubble can potentially burst, and when this bubble bursts inside the brain. So that's why we say that vascular malformation and aneurysms are like time bombs, because all of a sudden, when it least expected, it can burst and, of course, causing a brain hemorrhage.
And there aren't warning signs.
Sometimes there are, but sometimes there are. Sometimes if the aneurysm is close to a nerve that control the face, you can have cranial nerve palsy, you can have double vision, difficulty speaking. But sometimes the first sign of a ruptured aneurysm is the worst headache of someone's life and loss of consciousness. Some patients pass out immediately.
Can you fix them? Can you prevent them from occurring before they bleed?
Yeah. So this is a great advantage of the last 10 years, which is unprecedented. We're only able to decrease the mortality dramatically when someone with a brain, when a ruptured aneurysm comes to the hospital, but also we can repair aneurysms, we can fix aneurysms before they burst. So let's say someone has headaches, the neurologist thinks it's an atypical headache, they do an MRI, they find the aneurysm, then we can repair them. And in the old days, the only way to repair it is with the open surgeries. You had to basically crack the skull open, find the aneurysm, and clip it. Mm. But now we can repair it from the inside and from the groin, basically threading a small little catheter, and that's what I do pretty much every day. And then basically close this pouch from the inside. So without opening the skull, it's less invasive. The length of stay in the hospital is 1.5 day, if you
that's
can believe
amazing.
It or not, for brain surgery. And a study was just published that shows how that the increase of not only the length of stay in the hospital, also the mortality and the morbidity is dramatically decreased since we start using these new techniques.
Dr. Linfante, thank you so much for this very valuable information. We appreciate your time.
Thank you very much, June. It's a pleasure.